The video that you're about to watch was made by extremely busy members of the ship's company during a unique first year in the life of a modern warship. Those of us who were privileged to be part of the early success of HMS Illustrious can be justifiably proud, and I very much hope that this film will bring back memories of a remarkable year.
On behalf of the Admiralty Board, I authorize you to accept Her Majesty's ship Illustrious for service in the Royal Navy, and I would remind you that she is now entirely your responsibility.
I accept Illustrious.
Good.
Commodore, Captain Slater, ladies and gentlemen, I think you will agree with me that the circumstances surrounding the acceptance ceremony today were undoubtedly unique. When we were asked in mid-April how much earlier it might be possible to deliver HMS Illustrious, we quoted the date of the 18th of June. Although we recognized, in giving this undertaking, the enormous volume of specialized work, not to say the modifications, that would be necessary, and were the work that was still to be completed, that it required a tremendous effort. However, we Geordies always respond to a challenge, and thanks to the great team spirit and industry of all concerned, it gave me great pleasure and satisfaction to be able to offer Illustrious to the Ministry of Defence Naval for acceptance today.
The acceptance of Illustrious is a milestone for the Royal Navy. It's a most important milestone for the United Kingdom. And it's an extremely important milestone for the North Atlantic Alliance. In the face of the ever-growing maritime threat, Illustrious, the second of our new aircraft carriers, is a vital and powerful addition to NATO naval forces. From the Royal Navy in general, and from all of us in Illustrious in particular, well done and thank you very much indeed.
The Navy is delighted to get Illustrious today, delighted to get a ship so completely up to date out of the builder's yard, incorporating very many of the most important lessons that we've learnt recently in the South Atlantic in operating her sister ship and other ships. And it's a most remarkable achievement, which I congratulate you all and wish the very best at the start of what I'm sure will be a most successful commission. All that remains now is to exchange ensigns.
Thank you.
Down the carry-on.
Later, to save precious time, we held a commissioning ceremony and service at sea, a unique occasion.
I have received a commissioning warrant from Sir John Fieldhouse, Knight Grand Cross of the Most Honourable Order of the Bath, Admiral in Her Majesty's Fleet, and Commander-in-Chief of Her Majesty's Ships and Vessels, employed and to be employed in the fleet. The commissioning order reads as follows. The Admiralty Board, on behalf of the Defence Council, having directed that Her Majesty's ship Illustrious is to be commissioned at sea on the 20th of June, 1982, you are to proceed forthwith to commission her for sea service. On commissioning, you will be under my full command. You are to bring to my immediate notice and to the notice of the appropriate local authority anything which gives you cause for dissatisfaction with the ship or any part of her, and any other matters of importance, in particular those relating to the welfare of the ship's company. May God's blessing be upon the ship and the company hereby entrusted to your command, and may your joint endeavors to uphold the high traditions of the Royal Navy in the service of Her Majesty the Queen be crowned with success and happiness. Given under my hand this first day of June, 1982, signed John Fieldhouse, Admiral.
Let thy blessing be upon this ship and upon all those who serve and sail in her. May good success and thy protection and the guardianship of the holy angels always be with them. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Ship's company, help! On cap!
We've just taken part in a unique and historic commissioning, the first commissioning ever, I understand, of a ship at sea. However, to me, a commissioning is a family occasion when all our friends and relatives can be with us. And so I have every intention of holding a formal commissioning ceremony when our program allows it and when Her Royal Highness the Princess Margaret, who launched the ship, can be with us. Finally, gentlemen, 42 years ago, almost exactly, Captain Dennis Boyd, the captain of the Last Illustrious, the first captain of the Last Illustrious, a ship that, as you know, was famous in naval history, he wanted to find a motto for the ship. And he looked at our crest, and as you know, our crest is the three cross trumpets. And he looked in the Bible, and he read from Corinthians, "If the trumpet shall make an uncertain sound, who shall prepare himself for battle?" And so he chose the motto, "Vox non incerta," no uncertain sound. I can think of no better motto for us today. We have a fine ship, we have a famous name. We must now tackle, in the days, the weeks, and the months ahead, our task with no uncertain sound. Thank you.
Illustrious, help!
only 40 days and 40 nights were available for trials, for storing, for ammunitioning, and of course for a Portland workout, before we had to be ready for our deployment to the South Atlantic. Uppermost in everybody's minds, thousands and thousands were at Portsmouth Harbour entrance to wave farewell as we sailed for the South Atlantic on the 2nd of August.
Aircraft carrier HMS Illustrious set sail from Portsmouth this morning for the South Atlantic. She's taking back some of the Sea Harrier jump jets which fought in the Falklands campaign. Most of the Harrier pilots have had only a couple of weeks leave since they got home. Illustrious completed her sea trials in a record time of 6 weeks and she's now going to relieve her sister ship, HMS Invincible, in the task of guarding against submarine attacks.
Earlier, during the workup, we had the chance to salute the flagship Hermes as she steamed up channel on her return from the wall. Hurried south in company with Battle Axe and Amazon. In Illustrious, the new air group had to be worked up to fever pitch in record time. And of course, damage control and firefighting exercises and so on were continually done as the ship's company settled down in preparation for a long period of defense watches. Harriers here practicing their air defense and strike rounds. 15th of August, we reached the equator, and King Neptune and his court laid on a splendid crossing the line ceremony.
Slater, good sir, we welcome you here. I trust that you'll join us in a jug of beer.
Hear ye, hear ye. Whereas it has been represented to me by Captain JCK Slater that there are diverse persons on board Her Majesty's ship Illustrious who do sail the seas without royal permission and blessing. We do hereby summons all such persons who have not been previously received into our realm to present themselves for judgment, so that having paid such penalties as their crimes deserve, they may be enrolled into our kingdom, and hereafter they shall be entitled to sail the seas without let or hindrance. Given this 15th day of August, 1982. Signed, Neptunus Rex.
Passing Lisbon and Gib, you deserted twice. But you missed the Canaries. They're quite nice. Illustriously and in recorded time, you've brought all here to cross my line. But really, for leaving your ship at sea, the following punishment I must decree. A shave, two pills, and medicine sublime, and then a dip in the salty brine.
Despite the number of times he may have crossed the line before, the captain is always the first to be dealt with.
Chamberlain.
even the fleet master at arms himself escapes punishment.
Ship's Air Department. Naval Airman Seymour, Naval Airman Wood, Leading Airman Smith.
The Sea Kings of 814 Squadron concentrated on their anti-submarine role, but when we reached Ascension Island on the 16th of August, they helped transfer well over 100 loads of stores from the shore to the ship for subsequent delivery to the Falkland Islands.
Thank you.
28th of August, exactly 10 weeks to the day since we left the builder's yard on the Tyne, and on the very day that we'd been aiming at for months, Illustrious relieved Invincible off the Falklands, and the flag of Rear Admiral Derek Reffel, the task group commander, was transferred to us from HMS Bristol. Final salute to Invincible before her departure to the north was a most moving occasion and will long be remembered by both ships' companies. In fact, it was shown a few days later on national television at home. And so we assumed responsibility for the air defence of the Falkland Islands. The next few shots give you some idea of what the islands looked like only 2 months after the war had ended. This is Port William Sound with some of the ships taken up from trade. now a few of the landmarks of Port Stanley itself. That's the hospital there. And that's the governor's house. Further along we come to the hospital, another part of the hospital, and the post office. And now soon you will be able to see the war veteran Sir Tristram, badly damaged. Another war casualty, a British Harrier. In fact, the terrible debris of war was absolutely everywhere. Although the threat of a maverick Argentinian attack was ever present, Illustrious occasionally anchored off the islands, and our soccer team played the Stanley local 11 under pretty tricky conditions. We also took part in the Stanley Half Marathon, which was started in a blizzard. Infuriatingly, it started before the illustrious team had finished changing. But they were in good company, as the civil commissioner, Sir Rex Hunt, was also late. Overall, in fact, the Navy did very well, and the race, as you saw, was won by a sub-lieutenant from Glasgow, and our own Chief Petty Officer from 814 Squadron came second. In fact, all our competitors finished in more or less fine style. And even the Civil Commissioner survived the course.
Are as follows. The winner, Sub-Lieutenant Robinson, Royal Navy, HMS Glasgow, 1 hour, 10 minutes. Runner-up, CPO Scott, Royal Navy, HMS Illustrious. In Captain John Morris, Quartermaster HQ Lippy. And the first a lady in Miss Rhoda Felton, who made it in 2 hours 46 minutes and a half. And finally, our youngest competitor to finish, Simon Goodwin. Well done, Simon.
afternoon, sir. Would you like to say a few words for Illustrious Television on today's marathon?
Well, yes, indeed. I don't know how that number two, the runner-up, came in from the Illustrious, so you must have a big flight deck and you must keep very fit on that. I found them all coming in when I was less than halfway going out, and they beat me in by about, I think, an hour and a half.
At this period, the Royal Engineers were working flat out to extend the runway so that it could be used by Royal Air Force Phantoms and Illustrious Sea Harriers, therefore could be released. We'll be right back. Much to our delight and relief, the runway extension was finally completed by mid-October, and we presented the Royal Engineers with a special cake to mark the event. Shortly afterwards, the first Phantom arrived escorted for its final lap with a very long journey in ascension by two of our own Sea Harriers. Hercules aircraft had in fact been flying in and out of Stanley throughout our time in the south, bringing in vital stores, passengers, and of course the eagerly awaited mail from home. Illustrious turned over responsibility for the air defence of the Falklands on Trafalgar Day 1982, and after a fine flypast of all our 21 aircraft and embarkation of an additional two Wessex helicopters, we headed north for visits to the United States before returning home. We could now get on with some of our trials outstanding from build, such as the pre-wetting that you can see going on here. Thank you. we had already completed a number of most successful Sea Dart firings. So successful, in fact, that Illustrious won the 1982 Sea Dart Trophy.
Thy most gracious favor, and further us with thy continual help, that in all our works, begun, continued, and ended in thee, we may glorify thy holy name, and finally by thy mercy, obtain everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Deployment, the ship refuelled at sea regularly, and in fact the Royal Fleet Auxiliary Bramble Leaf was in company with us throughout.
Eternal Lord God, who alone spreadest out the heavens and rulest the great...
Of course, we had to maintain our operational skills in case a return to the south became necessary. Nevertheless, everyone was able to enjoy a very well-earned rest. After a weekend of sport and banyans in the United States Naval Base at Roosevelt Roads in Puerto Rico, we arrived in Fort Lauderdale in Florida on the 12th of November for a marvelous week of sun, generous hospitality, lots of sport, and some most enjoyable trips up country, particularly to Disney World. Thank you. this splendid visit was all too short, and our second visit on the eastern seaboard of the United States was to Philadelphia. It coincided with Thanksgiving Day, and needless to say, we were literally overwhelmed with invitations to join American families. On each visit, at the end of the ship's official reception, our own volunteer band beat retreat in the hangar. After a fast transatlantic crossing, the squadrons disembarked in the southwestern approaches.
Thank you.
Emperor's Grand Draw from Ford Escort Cup. The original plan was for Princess Margaret to attend the commissioning of the Illustrious last June, but unique in modern naval history, the carrier was commissioned at sea as she hurried to the Falklands. Today the Princess made up for it by going aboard the ship that she launched 5 years ago for a special service of rededication. The Navy's latest carrier has already logged 150 days at sea. She's the fifth Illustrious in the Royal Navy, and the commissioning cake made by the ship's cooks wasn't forgotten. Cutting the first slice was the captain's wife, Mrs. Annie Slater, and the youngest member of the crew, 17-year-old Paul Lee from Yorkshire.
Let thy blessing be upon this ship.
Next came the service of dedication.
And upon all those who serve and sail in her. May good success and thy protection and the guardianship of the holy angels always be with them, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And then from Princess Margaret, a reminder that Illustrious had relieved her sister ship, Invincible, in the Falklands.
As a result of this, of course, on a personal note, I was very glad to get my nephew, Prince Andrew, home. Now, when one launches a ship and names her, forever afterwards, one has a relationship with her, rather like a godparent to a child. So I look forward to a long and happy association with our famous ship in the years to come.
Hooray! Hooray! Hooray!
And finally came the spectacular climax. A fly past by Sea Harriers and Sea King helicopters.